Grace and peace unto you, children of God, from our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, I always thank God on your behalf for his grace, that in all things you are enriched by him so that you won't be lacking in any gift. I'm your professor, Dr. Stefeni. Welcome to the Master's Touch Masterclass. You know, these classes are designed to give you a firm foundation in the Word of God, and if you can't make it at the time of our broadcast, then know that these are archived for your study convenience here on Spreaker.com and also on our website, themasterstouch.org. God bless you richly as we begin to enter God's presence. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, we come into your presence with praise and thanksgiving in our hearts flowing through our lips. We exalt and praise you and your holy name. Lord, we thank you for the hearts and the minds that are hungering for you and your word and to know your will. We praise you for our Lord and Savior, your only Son, Jesus the Christ, and his finished work on the cross on our behalf. Thank you, Lord, for revelation knowledge, your rhema word, the logos word, and the gift of utterance. Bless those that have ears to hear, Lord, as you impart wisdom through your word. In the name above all names, the matchless name of Jesus the Christ. Amen. Did you come expecting to receive today? Well, if not, you won't receive anything from God, so elevate your expectation level, and you'll come away with a greater revelation and a greater heart and mind connection. Today, we'll be continuing our series on the end times as we go line upon line and precept upon precept through the book of Revelation explained. Revelation chapters 12 through 14 are explanatory prophecies that describe some of the major personages and movements of the second half of the tribulation period, beginning with the woman who represents Israel and her child who is Christ, the Messiah. Now, although chapter 11 verse 15 records the sounding of the seventh trumpet, the effects it produces are not described until chapters 15 through 18. Chapters 12 through 14 restate or summarize that same period. However, they're describing events from Satan's vantage point. Now, including taking the readers back to the original rebellion as Satan is cast to the earth along with one-third of the angels, the demons. Before we get started, I want you to remember that I'm giving you the scripture and reference, and then I'm going to give you the explanation. But before we do that, it's imperative that because this is all written in typology and symbiology, we need to understand it. So let's soak in worship right now and get into the presence of the Lord. Revelation 12, verse 1. And there appeared a great wonder in heaven, a woman clothed with the sun, and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. Okay, the woman represents Israel, and her child is Christ, the Messiah. Chapter 12, verse 5, Isaiah 7, verse 14, Isaiah 9, verse 6, Isaiah 66, verses, chapter 66, verses 7 and 8, 7 through 8. Micah 5, verse 2, and Romans 9, verses 4 through 5. Those are scripture reference for that. The woman is not the church, since the church didn't bring forth Christ, but rather he brought forth the church. The sun reflects redeemed Israel's unique glory. Brilliance and dignity are also included in that because of her exalted status and shows her as God's chosen nation. The moon under her feet alludes to God's promise of dominion, and the crown of 12 stars pictures royalty and relates to the 12 tribes of Israel. So go to Genesis chapter 37, verses 9 through 11, and read the story about Joseph and the dream that he had about the sun, moon, and the 11 stars, which were bowing down to Joseph, who was the 12th. Okay? I want you to, that's your homework. Do that. Now, in this, actually, I can do that. Maybe I should. Let's just do that because there's no rush to get through this material. And I want you to gain a complete understanding of that. So let's go to Genesis chapter 37. Turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 37. I got to put my glasses on, folks, so I can see. Chapter 37. That's 27. Chapter 37. Almost there. Chapter 37, verses 9 through 11. All right. And he dreamed yet another dream and told it his brethren and said, Behold, I have dreamed a dream more. And behold, the sun and the moon and the 11 stars made an obeisance to me. Obeisance to me. And he told it to his father and to his brethren, and his father rebuked him and said unto him, What is this dream that thou hast dreamed? Shall I and thy mother then and thy brethren indeed come to bow down ourselves to thee to the earth? And his brethren envied him, but his father observed the saying. Okay. Joseph was the 12th, right? And in this look toward heaven by John, we're taken to a different aspect of the battle that has gone on through all the ages between Jesus and Satan. If Jesus is in warfare with Satan, then his people are in battle as well. Okay, let's move on to Revelation chapter 12, verse 2. And she being with child cried, travailing in birth, and pained to be delivered. Women who have had children know that there is pain involved in birth, okay? This scripture is spiritually speaking of birth of Jesus and of Christianity. The birth pains refer to the period before the birth of Christ when Israel was waiting for redemption by the Messiah. And our reference for that is Romans 8, 22 through 23. Revelation 12, verse 3. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon having 7 heads and 10 horns and 7 crowns upon his heads. Okay, we see here this red dragon, and this is the devil, and he is shown red all over to show his murderous and destructive personality. This is the only place in the New Testament that dragon is used. There is not a literal dragon, but a figure of Satan. Okay, it's not a literal dragon, it's a figure of Satan. These 7 are heads of evil governments. This world power through these earthly kingdoms comes from Satan himself, and the 7 crowned heads means universal rule, and the 10 horns mean the world power to the utmost. Okay? 5 emperors had come and gone by the Apostle John's time, and 1 ruled during his time, and the 7th represents the Antichrist to come. His 10 horns show Satan's connection with the 4th beast of Daniel, chapter 7, verses 7 through 24, or 7 and 24, I'm sorry. And with the beast from the sea in chapter 13 of Revelation. That's where these 10 horns connect with those 4 beasts and that 1 beast of the sea. All right, Revelation 12, verse 4. And his tail drew the 3rd part of the stars of heaven and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman, which was ready to be delivered for to devour her child as soon as it was born. Now, when John tells us that the devil's tail drew a 3rd of the stars of heaven and threw them to earth, he's describing the original demonic uprising against God. Satan somehow managed to convince a third part of all of God's angels to join him in his rebellion. And these beings that we now call demons or fallen angels, they serve Satan and play an important role in the judgments of the tribulation. We also see here the woman is about to give birth, and this is the birth of Jesus the Christ. Satan used Herod to try to kill Jesus the moment that he was born, and that wasn't God's plan. So Jesus was protected until the time of the cross. This also indicates here the birth of the church, which is comprised of the image of God, us, and the devil has tried to devour the church every way he could. Revelation 12, verse 5. And she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up unto God and to his throne. Now this is speaking of Jesus Christ. Jesus was caught up unto God to sit on the right hand of God at the resurrection and is now still sitting at the right hand of God. Now when he returns, Jesus will rule all nations as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And during Jesus' earthly millennium kingdom, this rule is a breaking and shattering work of judgment. So, an iron rod is one that cannot be broken and speaks of the resoluteness of Christ's rule, and he will swiftly and immediately judge all sin and put down any rebellion. Revelation 12, verse 6. And the woman fled into the wilderness where she hath a place prepared of God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Okay. The wilderness represents anywhere outside Palestine. During the last half of the tribulation period, 1260 days is 3.5 years, Israel will take refuge among the Gentile nations where God will care for her. God will frustrate Satan's attempt to destroy Israel during the tribulation and will hide his people, just as Jesus stated in Matthew chapter 24, chapter 24 in Matthew, verses 15 through 21. Revelation 12, verses 7 through 8. And there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought his angels and prevailed not. Neither was their place found any more in heaven. Okay, the vision of war in heaven anticipates Satan's exclusion from heaven and his restriction to the earth during the last half of the tribulation. Michael, the archangel, is the leader of God's holy angels. Daniel 10, verses 13 and 21, chapter 12, verse 1, and Jude 9, chapter 9. Now, at some point during the tribulation period, God's going to empower Michael and his forces to cast Satan and his forces out of access to the second heaven, so that Satan must thereafter confine his activities to the earthly sphere. There is an order of command in heaven as there is here on earth. We see here that not only the church of the Lord Jesus Christ is being attacked here on earth, but that there is a war in heaven as well. Here we see defeat of Satan to such an extent that he is not allowed in heaven anymore, not even to accuse the believers. His defeat on this earth is complete as well. His doom was sealed when Jesus died on the cross and was resurrected. Hallelujah. Revelation 12, verse 9. And the great dragon was cast out. That old serpent, called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world, was cast out into the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Okay, so the evil one is given four designations. Number one, dragon pictures his monstrous character as the enemy of God. Two, serpent connects him with the clever deception of Eve in Genesis 3. Three, devil means slanderer, verse 10. Four, Satan means adversary, 1 Peter 5:8. Now, he also, he also deceiveth the whole world, chapter 20, verse 8. So notice here that we are told that the serpent that tricked Eve was the devil as well. You can call him by any name you want to. If whatever you call him is evil, it is the devil or his handiwork. Here we see that he deceived or deceiveth and is continually deceiving. In other words, he's deceiving continually the whole world. The devil runs to and fro throughout the earth seeking whom he may devour. Now notice that the devil doesn't even bother the lost at all. He already has them. He's after the believer, the image and the likeness of God. He comes to church regularly, trying to coax you away. He brings false doctrine and strife into the church. Check everyone and everything they say by the word of God. The deceiver will come dressed in sheep's clothing, and Matthew 7:15, verse 15 says he plants doubt and fear wherever he goes. And he does, doesn't he? The devil is the very one who brings in the feel-good religion. Beware, he is a destroyer. He appealed to Eve's flesh and destroyed her. The flesh is at war with the spirit. Do not listen to the flesh. Revelation 12, verse 10. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength, and the kingdom of our God, and the power of his Christ, for the accuser of the brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. Okay, the word salvation, strength, all right, Greek, dunamis, power, kingdom and power, Greek, exousia, authority, all refer to the coming of the millennial kingdom of Christ. He, the devil, is tossed out once and for all time. His day is over. The last half of the tribulation will be a time of terrible trouble on earth. Jeremiah 30, verse 7, Daniel 9, verse 21, Daniel 12, verse 1, Zephaniah 1, verse 15, Matthew 24, verses 15 through 22. That's your evidence. It's going to be Satan's final attempt to prevent the return and the reign of Christ, and he only has a short time to try to prevent the establishment of Christ's kingdom, so his wrath and his persecution of Israel intensifies. Now remember, Israel is God's chosen nation. Revelation 12, verse 11, and they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Victory is theirs. Thank God that his word does not leave the story of the tribulation saints with their earthly demise, but loudly proclaims their ultimate victory through the blood of the Lamb. And they, here, are the Christians. When Jesus shed his blood on Calvary and became the perfect Lamb sacrifice for once and for all time, Satan was defeated. You can see here the word of our testimony is when we open our mouths and declare that we believe Jesus Christ is Lord and also believe he rose from the grave. We will be saved. We must proclaim this, even if we know it will mean our life. We are not to regard life here on this earth as very valuable. The life that is important is in heaven. This world is not the Christian's home. We are just passing through. By that I mean it's not the Christian's home as far as where we came from. We are citizens of heaven when we are born again. Revelation 12, verse 12. Therefore rejoice, ye heavens, that ye that dwell in them, and ye that dwell in them. Woe to the inhabitants of the earth and of the sea, for the devil is come down unto you, having great wrath, because he knoweth that he hath but a short time. Okay. Here we Christians are told to look up and rejoice when we see terrible things happening, because our redemption draws nigh. The devil, even now, is in an all-out push to destroy the church as it used to be 50 years ago. He realizes his time is running out, and he's working on the believers, trying to convert them to his way. His scheme is to tell us not to be a radical Christian. He's trying to make us not take God seriously. He doesn't mind going to most churches because he hears very little pure word of God and no sermons on the blood. Watering down Jesus is one of his favorite tools to destroy the church. You know, it's going to be Satan's final attempt to prevent the return and the reign of Christ, and he has only a short time to try to prevent the establishment of Christ's kingdom. Therefore, he has great wrath and intensifies his persecution of Israel, God's chosen nation, by setting up his own counterfeit kingdom through the beast, the false Messiah. Revelation 12, verse 13. And when the dragon saw that he was cast under the earth, he persecuted the woman which brought forth the man-child. Okay. Satan's persecution of Israel is apparently an attempt to exterminate God's chosen people, thereby preventing the fulfillment of God's promise to Abraham and David in the Messianic by persecution. Now, Revelation 12, verse 14, and to the woman were given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness, into her place where she was nourished for a time, and times and a half time from the face of the serpent. All right, the wings of a great eagle represent swift escape from persecution. The eagle, in many instances in the Bible, is symbolic of God. It means that God will protect us in the midst of the problems, and this is what the sealing of the believers is all about. Our national bird is the eagle. Our nation was based and established on the word of God. So keep that in mind, and now we're rejecting him. That phrase comes from Daniel 12, verse 11. The sealing of the believers. And this refers to the second half of the tribulation, which begins by the abomination of desolation in Matthew 24, verse 15. Jesus said, when ye therefore shall see the abomination of desolation spoken of by Daniel the prophet, stand in the holy place. Whoso readeth, let him understand. Now, during this time, God protects Israel from Satan, who may know where the Jews are hiding, but will be unable to get at them because of God's divine protection. Revelation 12, verse 15. And the serpent cast out of his mouth water as a flood after the woman, that he might cause her to be carried away of the flood. The flood symbolizes overwhelming evil and persecution. Now, this imagery symbolizes trouble in general, folks, and Satan's force will sweep towards the Jews' hiding place like a great flood, so as to be drowned or killed or consumed by them. Revelation 12, verses 16 through 17. And the earth helped the woman, and the earth opened her mouth and swallowed up the flood, which the dragon cast out of his mouth. And the dragon was wroth with the woman, and went to make war with the remnant of her seed, which kept the commandments of God, and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. Okay, this is likened to the army of Pharaoh when all of his chariots were destroyed in Exodus 15. Verse 12 states, You stretched out your right hand, the earth swallowed them. This really angers Satan. He can't get to Jesus, and as we said before, so he is venting his anger on the followers of Jesus. And notice here that there is only a remnant left that has not fallen for the devil's false doctrine. A remnant means a very small portion that's left. You see here that this small portion, this remnant of Christians, are still keeping God's commandments, and even though the opposition has been great, they still have given the testimony of Jesus Christ. These two names, Jesus, Christ, together mean the Savior, the Anointed One. Now, the remnant may be a reference either to Jewish believers who have refused to worship Satan and his beast, or Gentile believers who are the seed of Abraham through Christ. Well, we're running out of time. Did you receive this today? I pray that you did. If you have questions or need further assistance with understanding the message, please contact me. I'm here for you. I'll give you my contact information. The website, themasterstouch.org. That's themasterstouch.org. My webmail, drstefeni@themasterstouch.org. That's D-R-S-T-E-F like Frank, E-N-I at themasterstouch.org. My regular email, masterstouchhs@cox.net, poet@cox.net, or mthsprayer@cox.net. I want to invite you all to join Pastor Karen Weitzman and myself every Monday on Spreaker.com at 10 a.m. following this program for Living the Word. This is a program that teaches you how to apply the Word of God, His promises, and His Word to your life today. So come join us on Mondays at 10 a.m. Pacific time now on Spreaker.com and come expecting to receive. My friends, remember, Proverbs 4:7 tells us that wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and in all you're getting, get understanding. And that's exactly what we're doing here, dear ones. We are gaining God's wisdom, so be sure you're keeping Jesus Lord of your life. The Master's Touch Masterclass is a subsidiary of the Master's Touch Healing School of Ministry International. We are a 501c3 organization. I'll see you again here in the master's class on tomorrow, on Tuesday. And so, God bless you right now.